Hi, I'm Joan Neuberger, editor of Not Even Past, and today we're here with Seth Garfield. Hi, Seth.
Hello.
Seth is a professor in the history department, and he specializes in Latin American history, particularly Brazilian history. And he's just written a new book about the rubber industry in Brazil during World War II that's called In Search of the Amazon, Brazil, the United States, and the Nature of a Region. So, Seth, let's start with a question that may surprise people. Why was the rubber industry in the remote Amazon interesting to people in the United States during World War II?
So at the time of World War II, the United States was a have-not nation when it came to rubber. It depended on imports predominantly from Southeast Asia. Over 98% of its rubber came from this region. There was no synthetic rubber industry in the United States. So when the Japanese invaded the Malayan Peninsula and the Netherlands East Indies, the United States lost access to 92% of its rubber supply. So this generated a major crisis in the United States. And they began to look for alternatives. And because of the Amazon's large number of rubber trees, that was seen as a good source.
Mm-hmm. So there was a war going on in the world, but this was also a special period in Brazilian history. Can you tell us a little about the Estado Novo and what people hoped for that?
So the Estado Novo was the dictatorship led by Getúlio Vargas. Vargas came to power in 30, and in 1937 he seized dictatorial control of the country. It's a very nationalistic time in Brazil. And Vargas was committed to not only economic nationalism, but also frontier development. So he upheld the Amazon as the future of the nation, as a source of natural resources, as a frontier to be settled and conquered by Brazilians.
Let me interrupt you for a second. What do you mean by economic nationalism?
So in Latin America in the 1930s, many governments embraced a form of economic development, import substitution, industrialization, because their economies had been so unsettled by the Great Depression, and they looked to producing domestically industrial goods that they had imported prior to the crisis. And for the automobile sector and for the military in Brazil, the Amazon's resources were very important.
Mm-hmm. So what was Vargas trying to do in the Amazon? What were his goals?
Well, it was a very ambitious project. He wanted to promote and to subsidize migration, because one of the problems that policymakers traditionally claimed bedeviled the Amazon was the lack of an abundant workforce. Mm-hmm. So it was subsidizing migration. It was also sanitizing the region, because it was a region that was plagued by numerous epidemics and public health problems. So there was an attempt to use public health and sanitation projects to make the region more salubrious. And there was also an attempt to grow blight-free rubber trees in the Amazon to compete with the Asian rubber trees that were grown on plantations.
Mm-hmm. So there was a big project to move people into the region, but there were people living there already, right?
Correct.
So what did they do with them?
Well, that's a very interesting question. The people in the Amazon, the Amazonian native population, which was comprised of predominantly non-indigenous groups, although there was a large indigenous population as well, were disparaged by government officials as being lazy, as not being ambitious or industrious enough to affect the transformation of the region. So it's not that there was a lack of workers in the region. Technically, there was a lack of willing workers to carry out the type of regimented labor that the government officials and bosses were looking for. So they looked to populations from outside the region, particularly the northeast of Brazil, who were celebrated as more industrious, more ambitious, and could bring about the transformation of the region.
Mm-hmm. So from the government's point of view, this was seen as a positive project, a modernizing project, right?
Yes.
But that was controversial, wasn't it?
Well, it was seen as a very nationalistic project. And what I argue in the book is that Vargas is not the first one to cast the Amazon as sort of an El Dorado or a future, you know, a region that brimming with promise. But he certainly was intent upon dispelling the idea of the Amazon as a green hell, as a region without a future, as a region condemned to backwardness. Mm-hmm. And part of his political project was very much raising support and consciousness and pride in the Amazon among the rest of the Brazilian population, the majority of which, of course, lives outside the Amazon region.
Mm-hmm. And were they successful?
Well, I argue, in a sense, they were, because the Amazon, I think, today in Brazil, is seen by those outside the region in complex ways. I think there is a sense of pride in the Amazon's bounty and the size of the region and its potential and its future, which I argue was generated in part, this type of cultural pride, by and under the Vargas regime. Mm-hmm. Although there still remain those in the more developed regions that see it as a dangerous, you know, snake-infested, malaria-ridden region that they would never visit if you paid them to go there.
And okay, so back to World War II, what did the U.S., how did the U.S. hunger for rubber affect national economic policies there?
In the United States?
In Brazil. So the U.S. really needed a new source of rubber. How did that influence what was going on there?
I see. Well, in general, Brazil was a key wartime ally of the United States. So in 1942, it actually, in August of 1942, Vargas declares war on Germany and Italy. And Brazil is the only Latin American country to send troops to fight in World War II. So in general, Brazil was the darling of U.S. economic and military aid during the war, and it fares quite well in terms of its macroeconomic, you know, performance. The Amazon in particular is also the beneficiary of millions of dollars in government, U.S. government aid and technology transfers. So for 2000, it would be the equivalent of over $110 million that were invested by the government. So this is, for a huge region, you know, not a tremendous amount of money, although a significant amount, given that it was traditionally a very poor region and chronically lacking in capital and technology.
Mm-hmm. So so what happens after the war then? What kinds of the development of the rubber industry during the war creates new conditions for afterwards? What happens afterwards?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I argue that the U.S. Develops a synthetic rubber industry during the war. So the geopolitical importance that had driven U.S. policymakers to the Amazon in sort of a frenzied pursuit of raw or natural rubber is no longer as important. So it's almost as if the Amazon lacks the urgency for U.S. officials, and they do withdraw the support, economic and technological, that had been offered. But for Brazil, the Brazilian government retains the subsidies that rubber growers had received during the war. And this whole nationalistic project that Vargas had developed is certainly sustained, so that the Amazon is, under the Brazilian Constitution of 1946, it's earmarked or to receive a certain percentage of national revenues. And this developmental project and regional planning is sustained for the course of the post-war period.
Mm-hmm. So when does it become, or does it become, a region where the rainforest is seen as something to be protected rather than exploited?
So I see that as taking place in the 1970s and 80s and onward. There is a significant amount of deforestation that takes place in the post-war period, some 12% by the 1980s, somewhat higher at this point. So there is a real change that's taking place in the region. But also, aside from the physical change and the acceleration of deforestation, there's the emergence of the environmental movement mm-hmm. Throughout the world. I mean, initially in the North Atlantic countries, but by the 1980s in Brazil as well. And this brings about a new valorization, a new importance, I think, for the Amazon as a source of biodiversity, as a buffer against global warming. And as a result, the image of the Amazon changes somewhat. It's not that there's still not a developmentalist impulse and many projects to transform the Amazon and to extract its resources for economic development and corporate enrichment, but there's a competing or countervailing project which obviously has made the politics or the eco-politics of the region quite contentious.
Mm-hmm. Now, you did research all over Brazil for this book, right? Including in some pretty remote places. So can you talk a little bit about some of the places where you went to do research?
Sure.
And were there snakes in the archives?
Well, much to my surprise, I found that the archives in the Amazon were a mixed bag. So some were poorly organized, as might be expected in a region that's poor or poorer than the more developed regions of Brazil. But in the city of Porto Velho, which is the capital of the state of Rondônia, I did research at a judicial archive, and it was one of the best organized archives I'd ever seen in my life.
How big is the town?
I think about 400,000 now. Uh-huh. So there were a wonderful archivist. Everything was, you know, on the database. I was able to find the material very quickly. So that was a very wonderful experience. Mm-hmm. And I found some excellent material there about the use of the courts by the rubber tappers and the use of the new labor legislation that had been enacted during the war that they brought to defend themselves against their bosses. I think one of the most interesting experiences was when I visited the extractive reserve where Chico Mendes, the great labor leader and environmentalist who was assassinated in 1988, had carried out his struggles against one of the ranches in the Amazon. And there I was able to tap rubber myself, and I was quite bad at it. So that was...
So you learned how hard it is.
I learned how hard it is. And it was also amazing to me in speaking with the residents to see how much they knew about the flora in the Amazon and how the different uses that, that they were able to apply to the flora in the Amazon, which was really eye-opening. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Great. Well, it sounds like really interesting research and an amazing place to visit. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.